Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Ujaswi Bhalla, a research scholar at Jawaharlal Nehru University, and I am presenting on behalf of Professor Jayaseelan. Today we will be dealing with module number 10 of Advanced Syntax titled The Theory of Government in Binding number 3. So in our previous module, we saw that the modules of universal grammar as stated by Chomsky were 6 in number, out of which we dealt with 2 in the previous lesson. Today we'll be dealing with the next 4 of those modules, namely theta theory, binding theory, case theory and control theory. So let's begin with theta theory. So theta theory deals with the semantic roles a verb assigns to its arguments. In GB theory, these semantic roles were called as theta roles. So in a sentence like John hit Bill, John is the agent of the action and hence is given the agent theta role. Bill is the sufferer of the action and hence is given the patient theta role. In a sentence like John gave the book to Mary, John is the agent, Mary is the patient, and book, something which is not directly involved in the action in an obvious way, is given the theme theta role. It's obvious that it is the semantics of the verb that determine what theta roles it assigns. It's interesting to note that we see parallel of our theta theory in Panini's Karaka theory in tradition and in grammatical tradition. It's not always easy to determine what theta role an argument gets. For example, look at the sentences on your screen. John loves Mary or I like chocolate. Now loves and like, they do not denote an action or an event. Rather, they are stative verbs which tell what state of mind the speaker is in. So it's said that it's clear that Mary and chocolate in such sentences are themes, but what theta roles that John and I get are called experiencer theta roles. Now look at the sentences on the screen. John saw Mary, John owns a car. Saw and owning, they are neither cases of actions, events, or of state of minds. So Mary in a car, it's easy to say that they get theme theta role, but it's difficult to determine what theta role John gets in these sentences. Thus, theta theory also has some unresolved questions of its own. Now that we have established what theta roles are, let's go back to the module of universal grammar and how theta theory gets into it. We have theta criterion that states that every argument must have a theta role and only one theta role. In the D structure, the position in which an argument enters and to which a verb assigns a theta role is called theta position. Now in D structure, every argument must have a theta role. If there is a non-filled theta position in the D structure, that sentence is not grammatical. For example, John hit or hit Bill. Hit takes two arguments and not giving one argument to it to fulfill its thematic grid leads to violation of theta criterion. Now that we come to movement, we say that when we have movement, it only targets non-theta position. To see this, let's see data. A sentence like it seems that John likes Mary is fine. Seems takes only one argument and that is a clausal argument. Its subject position is a non-thematic position. When it takes a non-tensed embedded clause, in that case, the subject position of the matrix clause gets filled by a dummy expletive it, because its argument is already given the theme theta role that it needs to give. Now let's see an instance where seem is taking a non-tensed embedded clause under it. Seem John to like Mary. In this case, John does not get its case assigned within the embedded clause because non-tensed T cannot assign a nominative case to it. Also, seem being an intransitive verb cannot assign accusative case to John by exceptionally case marking it. Thus, John has to move up to get its case assigned and it moves to this non-theta position of the subject position of the matrix clause and we get the structure John seems to like Mary. Now let's talk about the second module, binding theory. Binding theory talks about coreference of nominal expressions in a sentence. Nominal expressions in a sentence can or cannot refer to another nominal expression in that sentence depending on certain conditions, which we term as binding conditions. Just an example, a sentence like John thinks that he is genius is perfectly fine if John and he are coreferenced, but a sentence like he thinks that John is a genius is ungrammatical if he and John are co-referenced in this. But a sentence like he thinks John is a genius is ungrammatical if he and John are co-referenced. Now there are three broad categories of referring nominal expressions. They are anaphors, pronouns, and are expressions. Anaphors are terms like himself, myself, each other, etc. For example, a sentence like John loves himself. Himself is an anaphor in this statement. Pronouns are terms like he, she, they, it, etc. For example, he thinks that she loves him. In this sentence, he, she, him, all are examples of pronouns. Our expressions are basically any referring expression which is not a pronoun or an anaphor. So, proper nouns like John, Mary, London in sentences like Mary said that children like chocolate or the boy in the class loves Mary. They are all our expressions. Now that we have defined all the three types of our expression, let's move on to the binding principles that constrain what our expression can get coreference with what in a sentence. Our principle A states that an anaphor must be bound in its governing category. Principle B of binding theory states that a pronoun must be free in its governing category. Principle C states that an R expression must be free everywhere. In a sentence like John loves himself, we see that John and himself are co-referenced. To see whether himself is bound by John or not, we also have to check whether himself gets C commanded by John. And by the definition of C command, which we did in our previous module, we see that yes, himself does get C commanded by John. Thus, as himself is both C commanded and co-referenced by John in its domain, thus himself gets bound by John. One thing, the notion of governing category changes or expands theory by theory. For now, let's say that governing category is the minimal clausal domain that our expression exists in. So the term which binds your anaphor is called the antecedent for that anaphor. So let's see examples of application of principle A. The three sentences on the screen in front of you. Let's take them up one by one. Sentence A, John loves himself, as we have already established, is the grammatical case of application of principle A. Second sentence, John's mother loves himself, is ungrammatical if John and himself are co-indexed. Now in this, see that it is John's mother which is C-commanding himself and not John itself. Thus, in this sentence, himself does not get bound by John. Thus, it is a violation of principle A and this sentence is ungrammatical. In the third sentence, John thinks that Mary loves himself. C commanding is perfect. John is C commanding himself. But now there is a problem of governing category or domain. Our anaphor is in another domain and our antecedent is in the next higher up domain, which is too far up for it to bound the anaphor down below. Thus, we have a principle A violation in this sentence, because of which this sentence is ungrammatical. Now let's talk about principle B. Principle B states that a pronoun must be free in its binding domain. This is exactly opposite of what principle A stated for anaphors. If this is the case, then there should be a complementary distribution between anaphors and pronouns, which means that the environments in which anaphors can occur, pronouns cannot, and vice versa. So let's take the first sentence, John loves him. This is ungrammatical because in this case, him is being bound within its binding domain. John is C commanding him also, and John is co-referenced with him also, which violates principle B of binding theory. Let's see the second sentence. John's mother loves him. Now this sentence is perfectly fine because though John is co-referenced with him, but John does not see command him. Thus, John's mother loves him is fine because him as a pronoun does not get bound in the sentence, thus fulfilling principle B of binding theory. In sentence C, John thinks that Mary loves him. John is C commanding him, but John is in the higher up domain and it cannot bind him, which is in a lower governing category down below. Because of this, there is no principle B violation of binding theory and this sentence is perfectly grammatical. One important point to be noted is that anaphors and pronouns, they are different in terms of requirement of antecedent. For an anaphor to occur in a sentence, an antecedent is must required, but for a pronoun, an antecedent may be there in a sentence or may not be. For example, I saw each other is ungrammatical because there is no antecedent available for our anaphor each other, but I saw him is perfectly fine. Now let's talk about principle C of binding theory. Principle C states that an R expression must be free everywhere. Thus, in a sentence like John thinks that he is genius, even though John and he are co-referenced, they do not bind each other and John as an R expression is free, thus fulfilling principle C of the binding theory. In sentence B, which is ungrammatical, he thinks that John is a genius. He and John, though they are co-referential, but yet this sentence is ungrammatical because John should be free in this sentence. Now it's interesting to see that if our binding domains are separated by clauses, then we can have co-referential NPs in those sentences. For example, his mother thinks that John is a genius. In this, his mother is co-referential with John in the embedded clause below, but it does not see command John and hence John is free. Thus, this sentence is perfectly grammatical. Just like our theta theory, there are problems with our binding theory too. There are data which pose problems to this clear-cut principle distinctions. For example, two pair of sentences like John loves his mother, they love each other's children, they are perfectly grammatical. What principle A and principle B stated was that pronouns and anaphors should be in complementary distribution to each other. But in this we see that when we enter the domain of NPs, they can co-occur at the same place. His and each other's both occupy the possessor NP position of a noun. What could be proposed for this? So several suggestions have been made and the one which is carried forward is that the notion of governing category changes from anaphor to pronoun. In his mother, we see that his being a pronoun should not be bound within its binding domain. Thus, we say that an NP is the governing category for a pronoun. But because B is perfectly fine, we say that an NP is not the governing category for an anaphor. Rather, clause is the ultimate governing category for an anaphor. Thus, we differentiate between governing categories for anaphors and pronouns. Another problem which could be seen is the notion of PPs. Now we see two sentences where we have different types of PPs. John saw a snake near him or ungrammatical near himself versus John tells funny stories about himself versus ungrammatical about him. So now locative PPs could be governing categories for some and other PPs could not be governing categories for others. Move on to the next module, the case theory. Now, case theory has only one principle of utmost importance, the case filter. Case filter states that for any NP to exist in a sentence, it must have its case licensed. If there is an NP which is generated in such a position where it did not get case, then it has to move up and get its case licensed. We have seen two phenomena which deal with such type of movement. One was passivization, second was raising. The sentence in front of your screen was eaten the cake. Now in such situations, the direct object of a passive verb cannot get its case licensed by the accusative case of a verb because passive verbs do not have accusative case to give to its argument. Thus, this direct object has to move up to the subject position of the sentence and get nominative case licensed from the T head up in the sentence. So we get the passive sentence, the cake was eaten. Secondly, if we have a non-finalized clause as an embedded clause, then the subject of that embedded clause did not get its case licensed from that position, primarily because non-tensed T cannot license nominative case to the subject. Thus, this subject NP moves up to the higher position where it can get its case licensed. This movement, these two phenomena have already been dealt before. What's new now is, now what all heads can license case in GB? One is verb, which licenses accusative case to its object. Another is preposition, which also licenses case to its object. Now, tensed T license nominative case to subject of that clause, and we also have genitive case being licensed to the possessive noun within an NP. Just like the other modules, we also have problems in this module. So you see data in front of you. I gave a pencil to her and I gave her a pencil. In the first sentence, the subject I gets nominative case from the tensed T. The NP, a pencil, gets its accusative case from the verb, and two gives case to its object, her. But when we have constructions like I gave her a pencil, now we have two NPs and only one case licensor verb. So where does it get its case licensed from? That's a problem which was posed to this theory. There have been many solutions posited for it, but we will not be going into them right now. Moving on to the next module, that is control theory. To understand what control is, let us look at the data on the screen. In the sentence in front of you, I tried to leave. We do not have an overt subject specified for the embedded clause, but we understand that the subject of leaving is I itself. So now we introduce a new notion called pro, basically big pro. Now this pro is a phonetically null entity which gets co-referenced with a nominal expression already present in the sentence. And in this case, because this pro, which is now occupying the subject position of the embedded non-tensed clause, is controlled by the subject of the matrix clause, we say that it is a subject control sentence. Try as a verb has subject control environment. You can see this in the sentence on screen, where I and pro are co-indexed and I is controlling the nature of this pro. We have verbs of object control too. A sentence like I ordered him to leave. Him is the object of ordering and him is also the subject of leaving. To indicate this, we have pro, which is co-indexed with the object him. Then we have other verbs, promised and persuade, which take object and subject control pros respectively. Pros can occur as the subject of infinitival embedded clauses of two types, two infinitival and ing gerundial type infinitival. Example of first type is I like to eat chocolate, where I is co-indexed with pro head, pro subject of the embedded clause, and I like eating chocolate, where this ing gerundial infinitival clause subject pro is controlled by the matrix subject I. It's important to note that pro can only be the subject of non-finite embedded clauses. It cannot be subject of finite embedded clauses, like the sentence, I persuaded him that pro should come to the party. Also, pro can only be subject and not object, as can be seen from, I told him that I would see pro, or I asked him pro to see. With this, we come to the conclusion of this module. In this module, we dealt with four basic modules that are elemental in the conception of our universal grammar, and they were theta theory, binding theory, case theory, and control theory. Thank you.